Welcome. So I'm Sally Morton. I'm Dean of the College of Science, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the second of five talks planned for the 2017 J. Mark Sowers Distinguished Lecture Series in the College of Science. On February 1st, we heard from David Reitz, who's a physicist and executive director of the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory Project, or LIGO for short. I missed that talk, but I heard it was wonderful. I hope some of you made it. And tonight, we'll hear from Rice University's Naomi Halas, who's a renowned nanoscientist. She's received many honors, clearly recognizing her as a pioneer in nanoscience and indeed a rock star in the field of science and engineering. But before Dr. Halas is introduced, I'd like to acknowledge a special guest in our audience tonight, Mark Sowers. Mark is a longtime friend and supporter of Virginia Tech, the College of Science, and the Department of Physics. Mark's passion for science and discovery, as well as his incredible generosity, has made this new lecture series possible. This lecture series brings together Nobel laureates, scholars, industry experts, scientists in business, government, and medicine to this stage and brings together you in the audience, not only faculty and staff and students of Virginia Tech, but we also welcome the science-minded and curious people from throughout the New River Valley community. We're so glad you could join us here at the university. Pursuit and curiosity of all things science are part of our vision in the College of Science at Virginia Tech and our core values. We thrive on the experience and practice of science excellence, the joy and challenge of discovery, and the beauty and growth of both diversity of people and ideas, and the practice of ut prosum, that I may serve, which is Virginia Tech's motto. Mark exemplifies that service. He wrote to us several weeks back telling us why he wanted to sponsor these great talks at Virginia Tech, and I'll quote Mark. He said, "I feel that we may be at the beginning of a new era of physics, a time where great things happen, and I want to help encourage that, help to promote and bring awareness to those working on the cutting edge." That's inspiring to hear, especially as a scientist at Virginia Tech, where indeed we are pushing the boundary of what the cutting edge can mean. I know that Mark's curiosity and passion for physics and all things science are shared by all of us here tonight. Let us thank now Mark for his wonderful generosity. Thank you. Thank you so much, Mark. So now physics professor Dr. Giddy Cotterprice will introduce our speaker.
Thank you very much. This is my second introduction at this podium for the Mark Sowers Symposium. This is my great pleasure to introduce Professor Naomi Halas, which we used to share the same building at Rice University called Abercrombie Lab or building. And just to mention that she did her PhD from Bryn Mawr University, moved as a postdoc associate to Bell Labs, and has been at Rice University for 27 years. She's a pioneer in nanophotonics and also using nanoparticles in order to attack cancer cells for cancer therapy, which is, again, a very important research area for nanoscience and nanomedicine. I try to make her CV as brief as I could.
Please.
And just mentioning a few things, she is a member of the National Academy of Inventors, member of the National Academy of Science, National Academy of Engineering, and also a member of Academy of Arts and Sciences. And my personal note, I was involved talking to her student and postdoc. She is a great mentor for a diverse group of students. Long list of successful outcome in terms of postdoc and the students out of her group. And I always admire her success. And that's, I think, is a very, very important thing to have woman role model like Naomi Halas for people like me. And this is my great pleasure to introduce her and bring her to the podium. Thank you.
Thank you.
thank you so much. Thank you, Mark. These are a great thing that you do. It's a great thing for the university. Expands everyone's horizons. It's a great honor to be here. And I want to thank every faculty member and student that I met today for making my sadly short visit to Virginia Tech as really delightful as it is. I hope you didn't hear that slip of my tongue there. So I would like to, so I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of our work, and I will try to make this as interesting and as anecdotal as possible. The story is relatively simple. If I get a little technical, I realize some of the people in the audience might be here really from a non-technical background. Just hold on a minute. I'll try to bring things down to a very simple level within a minute. So if I seem a little technical, just be gentle with me, be patient with me. So nanoscience is about small things, and this is sort of where things started. How could we go from a really big, clumpy first solid-state electronic device, the transistor, invented in 1947, to what we have now, and which is dirt cheap, and with atomic scale precision, and that is the electronics of today. So we really, in terms of what electrons can do and what electricity can do, we can actually master control in many ways at nanoscale dimensions. Well, for people who work with light and photons, they're also interested in ways of miniaturization, and there have been actually many interesting Nobel Prizes to back up many of the transitions from very large large optics to microscale optics, the optics of optical fibers, to something much smaller. So what I have over here is actually something that is two small silver, small, they're about 100 nanometers across, silver disks positioned very, very close to each other, about 4 nanometers away. And if you shine light on this structure in the right way, you can focus light down to a tiny, tiny fraction of a wavelength of light, much, much below the diffraction limit of light. So there are ways using metals in particular that one can do pretty extraordinary things with light, and that's sort of the beginning of my story. So that actually, that little lensing, that nano-lensing that you can do with small metal objects has a name. It's called a hotspot. And it's a way to focus light down to the nanometer scale. So people have known about metal particles actually for millennia, not just decades or centuries, but millennia. This is a cup found in the British Museum, and it's probably also found in some chemistry books that people, even high school kids, have. It has a beautiful, gorgeous red color. One also sees this in the in beautiful stained glass windows in cathedrals in Europe. And this was made back in this cup lives in the British Museum, and it was made during Roman times. They didn't quite understand the chemistry or the alchemy of what they were doing, but what they were actually doing to make this beautiful red color was making very, very small gold nanoparticles, in this case gold-silver alloy, but basically the properties are gold. And this absorbs green light, and so therefore it transmits red, so you see this beautiful red material. It's called ruby glass. And you can take this basic idea that's an easy thing to make from just using with just a solid particle, and you can begin to ask, well, how could I control this property? And so in our work, really 2 decades ago, actually, we began to think about how we could make a simple variation of this, not a solid sphere, but a hollow sphere. And when you make it hollow like this, which basically you do by taking a small dielectric sphere, basically made of glass, it's also on the nanometer scale, and wrapping it with a thin and uniform coating of gold. So a structure like this, if you control now the dimensions of this gold shell, you can tune it to any color, not to just absorb green light and look red to the eye, which is also shown here, but really to many, many different colors of the spectrum. So it's a sort of the first introduction of how geometry at the nanoscale can actually manipulate light. So we can think of this in many ways as a nano lens. And we can also imagine many different ways, things to do with this. So this is the beginning of a lot of interesting structures. So if I'm a chemist, there are probably some chemists here, so I'm a chemist, I can go into the laboratory and I can make small gold colloid in about half an hour. I can also make these funny looking structures called nanorods. And I would find that they have, that these two structures will have very similar optical properties. I'm not going to get into the details of the spectrum. People who are familiar with this will know the details. But if, say if I'm an engineer, so say I don't know anything about chemistry, I can actually put on my bunny suit, go into a clean room, and I can make structures that are really quite similar. Okay, they might live on a chip of silicon or some other substrate, and I use very different tools, but the basic physics is the same. I can make structures with the same types of optical properties that I can make, and this is one of the reasons why this field has captured the imagination of people in so many different disciplines, because with a variety of different methods, one can make basically the same types of nanoscale optical components. And another interesting and really beautiful property of this is if I take two gold particles and I bring them together, and I just showed you that they absorb green light and they look red to the eye, but if I make a solution of them and I bring the particles together, all of a sudden they have a very, very different color. And the rationale behind this is actually a beautiful analogy between, between the properties, the resonant properties of gold nanoparticles and the simple wave functions described by the Schrödinger equation of quantum mechanics. So just if I take two atoms, right, one electron each, hydrogen atoms, and I bring them together, so they have their normal atomic states, I bring them together, then those wave functions are going to mix and hybridize, and they're going to form a whole different set of atomic molecular states, right, that we call molecular orbitals. Just in the same actually quite rigorous analogy, exact analogy, if I take two particles that are maybe 100 nanometers in size, 10,000 gold atoms formed into a sphere, and I bring another sphere of 10,000 gold atoms together, then I will completely change the optical properties, and this has a different states, and so it has different resonances. So let me show you what I mean by that. So we actually call these artificial diatomic molecules, just as if I was making oxygen, O2 or H2 or N2, just they have very different and molecular type orbitals. So what happens if I have individual gold particles? They look red. If I have pairs of nanoparticles, they actually would absorb the red light and appear blue to the eye, the complementary color. And I can show you that right here. So if I have a solution of gold nanoparticles, they look red, just as I showed you before. If I have a solution that's beginning to coalesce into these dimer structures, they look instead blue to the eye. So this is an interesting effect. It's a really big effect, right? Red-blue color change is a really big effect. And it's actually the origin, it's the mechanism behind the world's first plasmonic device. So this device is something that many of you have used. And it's a device you can buy in virtually any drugstore. And if I describe how this works, many of you will know exactly what this is. So this is a microfluidic device. And so this is sort of what it might look like macroscopically, but what is it? It's basically, so I'm trying to detect a certain chemical. So my chemical flows down this little microfluidic channel. And in this region here, it's pink because I have gold nanoparticles. And they have a little molecule on the side, an antibody, that's going to detect this chemical. And these gold nanoparticles are now released, and they'll flow further down this channel now that they've captured this chemical, until they encounter the second region where there are other gold nanoparticles. And so they form these little dimers. And so by eye, what I see is not a pink area, but it turns blue. So I bet some of you know what this is. It's a home pregnancy test. And it is, in fact, so it's called Clear Blue Easy. And so now you can explain it to the next person you know who uses this. And in fact, the sensitivity is because of the large optical cross-section of the plasmonic structures, which creates a greater detection sensitivity and therefore earlier detection times, which is why it's called Clear Blue Easy. And so you can explain that now to the next person that you know uses this. So as I said before, we made these structures that we call nanoshells, and they're quite, this is quite an interesting structure because as I control the relative size of the core and the shell, I can tune the resonance of this particle, and the origination of doing this, actually this idea of plasmon hybridization, then allowed us to make many types of nanoparticles of all of a core shell geometry, but all that had a different way in which we could manipulate light. So we have this gave rise to just a whole menagerie of tunable optical nanoparticles. And of course, the first one I show you is nanorice because if you remember, in the history of nanoscience, of course, Don Eigler wrote IBM in Xenon Atoms. So this tradition of naming something after your employer, if their name ends up on your paycheck, then maybe you want to put, you should do this. So we made nano rice. These are actually, for those of you who are interested, hematite particles covered with gold. We made some reduced symmetry nano cups. Those we made by evaporation. And my favorite ones, so those of you who, if your Russian is a little rusty, nano matryoshkas, which is, of course, like the matryoshkas are those nested Russian dolls that you can buy in the airport. And this is basically a gold particle surrounded by silica, surrounded by gold. And that coupling between the inner sphere and the outer shell gives rise to some really beautiful phono-resonant type properties. You can extend this to coupled particles, to nanowires, couple light in and out of nanowires in very precise ways, even making logic gates. You make structures that look a lot like molecules, a lot like diatomic molecules too, like CO, for example. You can extend this to other conductive materials. So something like graphene is conductive. And one can, it has a lower electron density than metals like gold. So it has resonances in the infrared, but you can also shape it by geometry and make tunable resonances with something like graphene. And you can make other sort of really remarkable three-dimensional structures. These are all very small structures made by an extraordinary chemist in Singapore. Nanoshells, as I showed you early on, and our recent interest is to move away from precious metals like gold and silver to aluminum, which also is a metal that is the most abundant metal on Earth. So it's very interesting for applications that would be sustainable, but that also have very tunable and beautiful optical properties, and it sort of opens up a whole new world of chemistry to try to make nanocrystals out of aluminum. So very early on with nanoshells, we began to, because the resonance can be tuned, so there's a very interesting phenomenon for those of you who are not familiar very much with optical properties. If you take if you tune this nanoparticle from absorbing green light to absorbing light just beyond what the eye can see, so there's red, green to red, and then beyond the red wavelengths, you go into the infrared, but just at the cusp between red light and infrared light, you have this region called the near infrared. For those of you who are technical, that's around 800 nanometers. And this is a region where the body is very transparent. So light can penetrate centimeters into the human body. If you've ever been in an emergency room and somebody's clipped a little red thing on your finger, you see that red wavelengths go right through the finger. You did the same thing with green light, it would just hurt, it would just absorb and hurt. And so together with bioengineers, we had an idea to develop this as a cancer therapy. So the idea is very simple. So these nanoparticles absorb near infrared light, which otherwise would pass through the body. If you inject them into the tail vein, say of a mouse, then the nanoparticles would circulate in the body for several hours, and during that time they would take up naturally into a tumor site, because tumors are spongy, they're grown very chaotically, and so they would naturally take up structures that are around the size of about 100 nanometers. That was a really well-known effect long before we did this. But then after you wait about 12 hours, you have this host of nanoparticles in your tumor, and then you just shine right through the skin. You shine this near-infrared light at the right wavelength that is absorbed by the nanoparticles. The tissue does not absorb any of this radiation, and so you can very efficiently heat up tumor, and this is actually what this looks like on a mouse. So this is this shows you the day of a subcutaneous tumor on the day of treatment, and then after treatment, you see at about day 12, you see the tumor is gone. There's a little bit of a residual, what looks like a scar, but that sloughs off at about day 14. And so the remission rate for tumors treated in this manner, this type of tumor, is close to 100%. And so that got us very excited. Back when we first did this work, we formed a company, and that company is now in clinical trials. And I'll say something more about that later. But some of the first clinical trials, the first person who was treated for head and neck cancer, I'm sorry to show you a picture after dinner of this individual, but he had quite a disfiguring tumor on his face that straddled his carotid artery, and this was treated very successfully. And so this work has continued, and there will be more about that later. So when I used to give talks a lot about cancer therapy, and always somebody in the back of the room would wave their hand and say, this is really a neat effect. Couldn't you use this for somehow harvesting harvesting light or doing some kind of solar energy. That would be really neat. And I would sort of scratch my head, yeah, that would be really neat. We never really figured out something to do. So then we began to think about this, and so we did some very simple experiments. So we all know how to make steam, right? We make steam. We made steam the same way for 10,000 years or more as humans. You take a big pot of water, and you put it on a fire, and then you wait, because you need to put a lot of energy in, right, to bring the temperature, raise the temperature of the water, and then the enthalpy of vaporization. So you have quite an energy debt you have to pay. But once you wait, you will make steam. Or if you really don't feel like waiting, you can do something else. You can take the same vat of water, and you can put in light-absorbing nanoparticles, and you can shine sunlight, and you will see that you will make steam right away, literally immediately. And you'll also find out, as I'll show you in a minute, that you'll make it very efficiently. But you'll make it even if you put the whole thing in an ice bath. So I'm going to convince you of this. So one way to measure steam, so I'll say I have a beaker of water, and I put in nanoparticles, and I could put the whole thing on an analytical balance. If I shine a laser, say, if the laser is the same wavelength as the particles absorb light, then I will see a mass loss, which just is a very convenient way of measuring the fact that I'm making steam, right? So the only way that we can lose mass is because we're vaporizing. And if I'm not on resonance, then I won't see any mass loss, I won't see any effect, because I'm not really heating the water, unless I'm somehow coupling in to the nanoparticles. So I have a video, which I'm not going to play because I lost my video, but it's so fast that I can just describe it, and it has the same effect. So let me tell you what this looks like. It's not lost. It's on my computer somewhere, but I couldn't find it, so I apologize. So we can take a test tube of light-absorbing nanoparticles, and we can stick a thermocouple in the bottom. And we can use that to measure the temperature of the water. We put the whole thing in an ice bath. And then we can shine light, focus sunlight on the test tube, and within 12 seconds we would see actually explosive steam generation, even with no temperature increase whatsoever for the liquid. So how in the world is this happening? So we can do this experiment, and we can measure things a little bit more carefully. So this is our solar lab. Some people use solar simulators, but we're in Houston, Texas, and Houston has the same latitude as Cairo, Egypt. We've got plenty of sunlight on sunny days. And so we do our experiments outdoors, have nice cafe chairs and things we could use. But anyways, very, very convenient. And so we're actually doing a very simple experiment. We have this beaker filled with water filled with nanoparticles that absorb light. And then we place this on an analytical balance, and we put a thermocouple inside. So I can measure two things. I can measure the temperature of the liquid, and I can measure the mass loss. So how much mass is consumed, how much steam is produced, and how much does the temperature increase. And I can use different nanoparticles, so nanoshells and carbon, and I can do this with different volumes, because if I just measure the temperature increase, so I shine light, this is my simple Fresnel lens, so I shine light, and if I just watch what the temperature increase is, of course I'm going to have, so the energy is a heat capacity times delta T for whatever my mass is. So if I have a larger mass, then the delta T is smaller. Smaller mass, then the delta T is larger, right? So that makes total sense. So what happens if I measure the steam generation? So it's independent, right? It doesn't matter how much liquid I have here. I have the same generation rate. And then if I look at how much energy is consumed by both processes, how much energy is consumed to heat the fluid, so this is in sort of this 4-minute window that I'm showing you here, corresponds to the experiment. And what I need to generate that steam, I find that actually the light is partitioned to about a little bit more than 80% goes directly into steam generation, and a little less than 20% goes into heating the fluid. So what could be going on here? So we published a paper, and we were very excited about it. It caused a lot of sensation, and we had this feeling. So what? We had really no good way to explain this, but we felt it was important to report it. So we had this idea. So here's our light-absorbing nanoparticles. And of course, they will absorb light and they will heat up. And so we had this idea that they were sort of forming bubbles around themselves, and then they were sort of rising to the surface and releasing the bubbles. And we thought, this is I'm not quite sure if we can explain all the details, but this certainly made a lot of sense. This must be going on. And then we spent my best postdoc and my best student and I worked so hard for about a year trying to look for how we could visualize this tiny bubble. And the harder we looked, the more it eluded us, until we realized that that actually was not the explanation for this. And I'm going to explain to you also why. So if you think about it for a moment, it actually shouldn't make any sense. Because this is a metal particle surrounded by water. It's in a water bath, right? The water bath should win. There's no reason this should be, that we should have a big temperature increase. There's no reason we should be making steam. So if you do the heat transfer analysis for the amount of energy that we're putting in by sunlight, by optical absorption, and then we look at this sort of same nanoparticles, which we know the optical cross-section, so on, surrounded by water, then we should have a temperature increase that's just enormous, right? 0.04 degrees. I mean, it's absolutely minuscule. So there's no temperature. There shouldn't be any temperature increase here. So what is going on? And so we weren't the only ones who noticed that that was really, really strange. I'm going to say some more about that. We actually did experiments on individual particles, and we made bubbles on individual particles, and we measured how much light it took to make a bubble on an individual particle. And that also told us we were off. The amount of energy it took to make an individual particle, make a bubble from an individual particle, was about 3 orders of magnitude larger than what we were seeing in our solar experiments. But we weren't the only ones. So this wonderful paper, so we were just talking about this group at MIT, wrote a wonderful review article, and they were looking at lasers exciting bubbles and on particles. But then they found this funny data over here. Okay, so everybody's experiments lined up over here with all this much, much more energy, and here's ours way over here. And we say, oh, this paper here, reference 25. Puzzle is that the theoretical estimate of the nanoparticle temperature rise in 25, which is based on the calculation of the absorbed power in the solution of the Fourier law heat conduction equation, only 0.04 degrees, and that's, of course, our data point. So it's fun to see that in the literature. So what is going on? So what's going on is actually quite interesting, and it's actually an interesting regime of physics that for actually quite interesting reasons has been neglected by the physicists and the chemists. And so what's going on is really a regime of multiple light scattering. So these particles that we use absorb, they scatter light. So we can think of individual photons coming in. So let's pretend we have our light-absorbing nanoparticles, and here we have a laser coming in. It's basically the same process. So individual photons come in, and they'll scatter off of one particle and scatter again until eventually they get absorbed. So there might be one scattering event. There might be 10 scattering events. But we're in a regime where the concentration is such that and the scattering and absorption processes are such that we have both scattering and absorption in this type of regime. So it turns out that's a very interesting regime. Physicists love light scattering. There are very interesting, beautiful physics associated with this called the weak Anderson localization of light. But when you try to look at light localization experiments, you cannot have any absorption. That screws up the experiments. So people who work in this area of light scattering, they cannot use absorbing particles. But here, absorption is really important. We're coupling in energy. That's what makes this effect interesting. So we're already out of the regime where the comfort zone for physicists, where a lot of people have studied. We're doing something very different. So what are we looking at? So what I showed you was you know, basically the cartoon of Monte Carlo simulations for sending in sending in photons to interact with a solution of particles. Then that solution both scatters and absorbs light. And so so this is the same in Monte Carlo simulations. Each one is several million photons coming in. And what's different is we're changing this concentration of the nanoparticles, and we're making them denser and denser. And you can see what happens to the light. This is the light that gets scattered away. And so this is like we're looking at the front face of this cuvette. Okay, the light comes in this way, and we're just looking as if we were taking a picture, right? And so the light scatters here. It's more compact here. And here you even see this coherent backscattering of light, which is actually a signature of Anderson localization, of weak Anderson localization. And we did this simulation, and we said, you know, we should be able to go into the lab and just take pictures of this, and it should look exactly like this. And in fact, we constructed the experiment where we had the same concentration of nanoparticles with the same absorption and scattering cross sections, and then we went for three different exposures, and we found, we made an image that was just remarkably similar to what we were calculating with our Monte Carlo simulations. Why did we use Monte Carlo? For those of you who are theorists, the reason is there is no way to, there's no approximation here. It has to be, really be a brute force method. People have done different types of approximations for diffusive transport, but those things really don't hold for us. Okay, so what's going on? If we calculate instead, because we know now, we have a lot of confidence that this Monte Carlo picture clearly looks exactly like what's going on in our solution of particles. So what could be going on? We have, again, three different concentrations of particles, but what we're going to calculate instead is where does the energy get absorbed? And so if I look at this for the highest concentrations, what I find, for example, is that we're actually, it's actually a light trapping effect, where the scattering plus absorption means that all of the light energy, all the energy gets concentrated in a tiny little sliver of fluid, just several tens of microns near the surface, right at the interface between the liquid and the vapor. And if you're trying to vaporize a fluid the most efficient way, you don't want to heat it from below and heat a whole volume of fluid. You want to only heat it where you need to, right? And so we're boiling upside down, right? We're heating upside down, but in a way, but and nanoparticles in light give us sort of the most efficient handle to actually make steam the way we should have been making steam all along. So we can take this. So this now sliver of where all the energy gets absorbed is now our source term in our heat transfer calculation. And we can, if we then follow through, we can actually reproduce the experiment where we measure, so the ice bath experiment. Remember, I measure the temperature at the bottom. It doesn't move. The temperature at the top, it must be very hot because I'm making steam. And so now we can, with in the lab, we can take a little cuvette, right? And we can shine an infrared thermocouple in the top and one in the bottom. We can measure those temperatures while we're irradiating. And we have our experimental data here and our simulations here for the same type of nanoparticles. So we really, really understand this effect. We really understand it very well. So that's exciting. And it turns out it's directly relevant to a whole lot of interesting areas that are related to like photothermal cancer therapy, because tissue is highly scattering. So we put absorbers in, and they put them into a scattering medium. So that's actually going to affect the way the light gets distributed in a tumor. And so we have what bioengineers, in their very sophisticated way, call a Goldilocks problem. If you have not enough nanoparticles, then the light will pass through the tumor. If you have too many nanoparticles, the light will backscatter out the tumor. And if you have just the perfect concentration, you'll actually penetrate the light through the tumor, and it'll actually result in uniform tumor heating. In practice, this is solved by taking an optical fiber and sticking it in all different directions inside of a tumor. But that actually is, but this is the actual rationale for why this has to be done, because you never have a good idea of what the actual quantitative concentration is of the absorbers that have collected in the tumor. So one has to figure out ways to make this work. So just to tell you the final story about there has been a lot of excitement just in the last 2 years by urologists for using this method to treat prostate cancer. And so this is really quite rapidly, because prostate cancer is a very common cancer. This has moved now into the clinic in 4 hospitals, 2 in New York City, 1 in Houston, and now the University of Michigan Medical Center is also doing a prostate cancer trial. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with prostate cancer, the reason is not fatality, the reason is lifestyle, because if you can compare this type of treatment and what the complications could be, and now this has been verified by more than 10 patients versus radical prostatectomy, and you see what the complications are here, you can see that there is a huge amount of excitement for the practitioners that they could bring something that would have very few complications to this large patient pool. So if we take away the photothermal aspect for just a second, and we can talk about another really interesting effect. Okay. So we had a fog here yesterday. We had a fog at the airport. So this is fog-inspired science. So say I want to image a scene through a fog. Okay. So we know what happens to the photons. To get a clear image, we'd have to transmit all of the photons, right? If the fog wasn't there, you would transmit all of the photons ballistically, right? But if you have a scattering medium like fog, then what's going to happen is the photons are going to encounter, they're going to multiply scatter, and some of the photons won't. They'll go right through. But some will scatter, and so then the result is that you have a really poor image. But that's if you have scatterers. But what if you add absorbers? So a very interesting thing can happen. So if I add absorbing particles, then it turns out that the probability of absorbing a photon is proportional to the path length, right? It's related to the path length. So you would think then that by adding an absorber, I'd be able to preferentially gobble up. So you know, yeah. So maybe some people here don't believe me, but would preferentially gobble up the scattered photons, and I would proportionally have more ballistic photons, and I'd actually be able to see an image. So that would be very interesting. And so we looked at this, and in fact, it's quite a dramatic effect. So we took scattering particles, and then we added an absorber, and we actually can see, so this is our resolving power here. So this is how, if you want to resolve a small object, if you want to resolve a large object, so it could be a human being, that could be a car, right? Or a tank or something. And as you add absorbers, you find that your resolving power gets better and better as I add them, but only for certain types of scatterers. So if the scatterers are small, this is a really big effect. But if the scatterers are large, then they scatter only in the forward direction, and so the effect is very, very tiny. So it sounds like a wonderful solution to seeing through a foggy medium, but the water vapor are big particles relative to the wavelength of light. So that actually won't help me with fog, it won't help me with dust, and it won't help me in tissue either, because the structures that scatter light in tissue are cells, they're big things. And so this is so light in tissue scatters very strongly in the forward direction, and it turns out that it isn't helpful, but at least we understand it now. Maybe we can use it in interesting ways. So back to photothermal. So what can we do with this photothermal effect? So we're thinking about this, and clearly we can make we can make steam very easily. And if we have this in a volume in a container, we can actually go to high temperature steam very, very rapidly, in less than 5 minutes, in this funny little contraption that we built. And I realize it's ugly, but I love it. So here's our Fresnel lens again, and here we have a little solution of nanoparticles way down here, and we make steam. And we have a sterilizing vessel here. So an autoclave is just a sterilizing vessel. So if you're in a molecular biology lab or a biochemistry lab, you have to keep everything sterile. So you have a piece of equipment in the lab, and you put all your things in this autoclave, and then you turn it on, and then they become, because of very high temperature steam, they become completely sterile. So this would be a wonderful thing to be able to use, for example, to sterilize, say, dental instruments in resource-poor settings. Because when people go on medical missions and dental missions to the developing countries, 90% of the weight that they carry with them is the chemicals that they need for sterilization. So it might be tempting to actually, if you have dental instruments and you have a lot of patients, to maybe not sterilize between patients. And that could be really quite awful, so we don't want to think about that. But a simple unit like this with off the grid, right? There's no input power except sunlight, but this gets us into a sterilization range that actually can denature viruses in a short period of time. So the next stage, so I like this part of my after dinner conversation, is to talk about sterilizing human waste. But this is a topic of major interest to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And if you look at the statistics, you can see why. So this is something that impacts a large fraction of people on the globe. And then that's basic sanitation. So there's a mommy and her child, and this is the pit latrine that is used for really many people in her family. So this causes a lot of waterborne illnesses, the lack of good sanitation. And so very often the children in sub-Saharan Africa, for example, are subject to diseases just based on the fact that they don't have the kind of clean waste processing that we have. So the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation put us in touch with a company called Sanergy, which was based at MIT. And so it's a franchise model for pit latrines, for clean latrines in the city of Nairobi, Kenya, where they basically start with, so these are franchise owners. And people will pay to use a nice, fresh, clean toilet. in the city, because otherwise there is no civil infrastructure in the city. So they have sanitation units, which are very well loved and very popular, and then they're emptied periodically, very frequently, and then the waste is collected and processed by these nice ladies. And the end goal is to use this. If you can sanitize waste, you can use it as fertilizer. But of course, you can't use it unless it is sanitized. And so the problem is in the transformation, right? Because it costs a lot of energy if you want to create steam to actually process waste. And so very early on, this is actually a solar steam unit, the first one that we built. And we sent a variation of this to Sanergy, and they have this up and running in one of their small distribution centers. It's a very networked type setup, and so they're testing this as a unit that will get them off the grid, so the whole cost of processing, which is the whole issue here, is something that can be reduced, and the franchise model can be more viable. So it's really fun to talk about steam, but after all, I'm on a college campus, and it's much more fun to talk about making whiskey instead. And this is also a process, so distillation, or vodka, depending on, you know, how you're leaning. So this is also an incredibly energy-intensive process, but we just accept it because it's so useful. It's part of technology. It's a mature technology. People don't do research in distillation because it's so very, very well defined. Ask any chemical engineer. You'll see their books on processes and so on. But distillation is amazing consumption of energy. So if you look at some of these numbers, so 18% of all of manufacturing energy in the United States is consumed by this one process of distillation. And there really is no alternative technology. People develop different types of filtration and so on, but nothing really substitutes for the precision and the separation that one gets with distillation. So let's think about bioethanol, because bioethanol is just like making whiskey. Right? We start with some feedstock. And we'll talk about a little bit more about that in a second. But we're basically have a feedstock, and then we add some yeast, and we make beer, right, to about 10% till the yeast dies. And then we distill it, and we make bioethanol. So in this country, we use corn. In Brazil, we use sugar cane. But we basically have the process is basically the same. And so because distillation is so energy intensive, if we make bioethanol, about roughly 75% of the energy cost for making bioethanol, which we have to use, right, by law, we have to use bioethanol, right, it's on all the gas pumps, is this one process, distillation. So it would be really quite, and we subsidize it, of course, because this is all part of how this is done. So it would be great if we didn't have to pay this enormous energy cost of distillation to make the bioethanol. So we thought, well, let's go back to our outside lab and let's put nanoparticles in our little flask, and let's build a little, make a condenser and so on, plug in a condenser, and let's look at the distillate. So we compared solar versus thermal, and we found, first of all, when we did this with sunlight and nanoparticles, we got a lot more ethanol off in a much shorter period of time than we did for the equivalent thermal process. We thought this was very strange. It seemed much, much more efficient just looking at the volume. But then when we looked at the actual process, we thought, oh, this is really quite extraordinary. Because what we saw was that the ethanol that came off was actually much, much richer, right? Much, much higher fraction of ethanol came off in the distillate than one normally sees for a thermal distillation. If you remember the ethanol water distillation curve from your high school chemistry textbooks, you have this mole fraction, and then you get up to 95 mole fraction, and you can't make it any purer because they don't separate anymore. It's something called an azeotrope. And so we see this really incredibly high fraction. In fact, we even don't see an azeotrope anymore. In fact, we could actually make quite dry ethanol by using this fully solar process. And so now I have to tell a little story. So Oara Neumann, who's now a research scientist in my group, she was really the mother of all of the different solar steam variations that I showed you thus far in my talk. And when she started working on ethanol, just to do a proof of concept, she thought, well, the simplest thing would be if I just go buy a bottle of beer, and then I pour the beer, and I just see, can I make ethanol from the beer? And so it's a nice, bright, sunny day, so she gets up early in the morning. It's going to be a great day for a solar experiment. So she goes to Whole Foods Market, and as soon as they open, and she rushes over to where they sell beer, and she's looking and looking and looking, because she doesn't drink beer. She's looking, and then somebody comes up to her and says, may I help you? She says, I am looking for the highest alcohol content beer that you have. and he looked at her and he said, oh, young lady, that's not the answer to your problem. And she was stunned. She had no idea what he was talking about. Because of course it was the answer to her problem. She wanted to do an experiment that day. So anyway, this is quite a remarkable result. So I mentioned bioethanol. So this is sort of the path for bioethanol we've been talking about. So if you're in Brazil, you make sugarcane. You start with sugarcane, or we grow corn here. And we can talk about whether or not that's ethical or not. It doesn't matter. It's an industry, so we can, you know, deal with that aspect of things. And then you ferment, and then you could distill this way, and you can make ethanol. But, you know, people have for years talked about this other idea. Could you take something really, really cheap that we don't eat, that we can't eat, like grass, right, hay, or wood chips or something, and could we somehow process that? And we know that we can, because what happens if, so that what we built earlier that I showed you for the autoclave is basically like a pressure cooker, right? We can make hot steam. It's a great way to overcook vegetables, right? So you can break down vegetables into mush if you just put them in here, and then you get, and then the liquid that you extract is going to be filled with a lot of sugar, and then you can ferment this, and then you can distill it, and you can make ethanol start to finish from something like this. And so let's try it. So we decided to try this, and so we did. So the first stage is to put in basically we use coastal hay. So this is what the setups look like. And because every good research group has somebody who knows how to make beer, it was very easy for us to find a graduate student who could tell us the proper way to do fermentation. And we just buy beer at the grocery store. And I mean, we know yeast, not even brewer's yeast, but it's just simple yeast at the grocery store. So we could go from making our feedstock and then fermenting the feedstock and then distillation. And so we go from those of you who are organic chemists and have been missing looking at a molecule, here's some molecules for you, here's all the sugars that you can extract from coastal hay. They have a whole bunch of different sugars, and a bioengineer would look at that and say, oh, I can engineer lots of things that could digest all of those, but we didn't have time to do that, so we just wanted to look at glucose, right? So the glucose is there. It's one of many sugars. If you look at the same curve for sugarcane, okay, sugarcane is engineered to have a lot of glucose, so this is glucose for sugarcane, right? And so this is Bermuda grass that we use. So we were able to, we run the experiment with sugarcane, because if this doesn't work with sugarcane, we should just give up, right? So this, see if it works. Here we have much smaller fraction of sugar, and we have some other things in there too, so it should be much less. And so then we try the whole experiment, we do the fermentation and the distillation. And then the result is that we actually do get, we get exactly what we thought. We get out sugarcane. It's not an optimized process. Shell has optimized this process for Brazil tremendously. But we certainly have this peak relative to what we see for coastal hay. And this was just recently published in ACS Energy Letters about a month ago, and it's open access if you're interested. So the last story is about water. Water is another one of these tremendous grand challenges that we need to be addressing, right? Because there are very large populations, even here in the US, that do not have good access to municipal water. Populations, for example, at colonias in South Texas that are very isolated, and they're not on any sort of water access. And if we look globally, actually about a billion people on the planet don't access clean and safe water. So not only do we have this problem with people, but we're also really, really good at making dirty water. So we have industries, both oil and gas, and also agriculture that generates a lot of wastewater, and that's very costly for them to figure out how to do the remediation for this. So we have a lot of dirty water. It would be wonderful to use water. If we look globally at all of the water on the planet, just a very tiny fraction is fresh. And if we sort of then go further and we look at where this ends up, we find that there's very, very little of the actual planet's water that is accessible. So we have many desalination plants worldwide. But the interesting number is that the big barrier is in the energy that it takes to do desalination. So 50% of the cost of desalination is in the energy that we need to do it. And so if you want to provide water for people, then you have to increase the carbon footprint in order to do so. So we have a problem with that. so it would be nice to figure out how we can deal with that. So there are different technologies. Reverse osmosis is good, but not good for highly salty water. So seawater is not really, RO is not, or reverse osmosis is not the best technology for that. So membrane distillation is an interesting technology. I like to call it a 40-year-old technology of the future because it's been around for a long time and it's a very highly energy consuming. So basically, what are you doing? So you have the input water flows here, here's a membrane, and here's the distillate flows in a counter flow. It doesn't have to be this way, but this is a convenient way to do it. And this is driven by both the chain, a difference in delta T. So if there's not a temperature difference here, then you don't have a vaporization of water through the membrane and then condensation on the other side of the membrane. So the temperature doesn't have to be that high as it is in free space. So the temperature difference is small for this process to work. You also have a difference in vapor pressure, but also you need, the problem here is you need to heat all the water. So we're back to the same problem that we saw, you know, in the beginning, right? We want to make steam, we had to boil a lot of water and put in a lot of energy. So here, here, can we figure out a way to convert this into a different type of process where we can use what we just learned, right, for how to make steam easily and with much, much less energy. So as I said, this is very, very energy intensive. So instead, we decided to convert this to a solar process. So we'd make a little coating on this membrane, a standard membrane, but we put in our absorbers. We used carbon black also as we used nanoshells. So carbon black is our absorber. And we put this in this scattering medium. And here we don't have any delta T, because the only delta T we can put in the same temperature water here as the output, and it's all created by the local photothermal heating that's generated by solar irradiation. So as I said, we use carbon black. Carbon black is great for solar because it corresponds really nicely to the solar spectrum. It's very, very broadband, and it's very abundant, and it's quite safe. So then we make our little membrane, as I showed you. We have a Goldilocks problem. How much absorber do we need to actually to precisely heat as much of this region as possible to generate a steam most efficiently? So it turns out there's an interesting problem in optics. We're back now to scattering and absorption and using our Monte Carlo simulation to understand what the effective absorption is. So we tailor it just precisely for the thickness of the membrane. And so we're building now an optically responsive membrane. It's something that doesn't exist before this idea. So here's the right concentration. And then we have a wonderful colleague who now takes, so those of you who might be engineers and use COMSOL for modeling things, so you basically use every single aspect of computational modeling that you can think of just fits naturally into this problem. We start with our Monte Carlo simulation, which gives us input to Maxwell's equations, and then we have fluid dynamics, Navier-Stokes equations, and then we have, of course, heat transport, and then we have mass transfer also to describe this entire project. And so it turns out that Alessandro Alabastri is about the best person on the planet to put all of these things together and form and build an accurate three-dimensional model for exactly that process. And so when we built one experimentally, it's really tiny, but still it gives us a very good picture of how this works. And so we're actually, with unfocused sunlight, we go outside, so this whole thing lives in a box, and here we have a focused sunlight, but this is data for unfocused sunlight. We're actually able to collect some water, and if we look at the, so I'm not going to go into the details here, of course, we had focused sunlight, and we are actually able to see very reasonable distillate flux for this tiny little window that we're using. And if we project forward to this, so what's so powerful about building a theory model is that we actually can now understand, if we make the system really big, how it works. And it turns out that instead of this older system of membrane distillation, if we illuminate the membrane, we actually can make this so that if we make the system bigger, if we scale it up, it actually is more efficient if we scale it up. So this is, as we make the system more efficient, when we increase its length, then our flux goes up. And for the conventional reason, the conventional approach, the flux actually goes down, gets less efficient, because delta T is never as good as when you first put it into the system. But here, we're making the delta T because we're using solar irradiation along the whole path of where the water flows to make the temperature hotter, and that actually drives the system. So the process scales up. It's actually more efficient if the fluid doesn't flow that fast. which is actually okay. We're not building this for a factory. We might be building this for something you put on a truck or you put on the roof of a house, and it would actually run this way. So the bottom line, we could actually take this system. It's just basically a membrane with water flowing different ways. So it's like a solar panel, but it's a desalination panel, right? So it's something you could think of having this as a 1 square meter. So if we project our numbers for this, so a desalination panel of this type for about 1 square meter would produce daily drinking water for 3 people, completely off the grid, completely off the grid. That means you could have it anywhere, the most remote location. And if you add focusing, then this actually increases. This number is a little bit generous. I'd say more a little bit closer to 10 or 12 persons a water supply. That's drinking water only, okay? So you're not bathing in this, right? But it's enough to survive, and it's enough for safe water. And so this is the first pass, and there's, of course, some optimizations that goes into this. But we're very, very excited about the idea that this could be a really portable, off-grid solar technology. It could be very useful for small families and for people in remote locations. So there's many things. So when I started talking about different aspects of science, I just want to, of the science of plasmonic nanoparticles, there are many, many other fields like chemical sensing, a lot of interesting physics associated with these structures where we can look at things like coherent phenomena, new different types of devices, different types of mechanisms for photodetection and even camouflaging, display technology, other areas in which this could can impact nanomedicine, and as of course I've just showed you some examples of light harvesting, and there are of course other applications where this is useful too. So this is one of the reasons this field is so exciting, is it can, just as I've showed you some illustrations today, it can also impact other fields in a very disruptive and exciting way beyond the things that I've showed you today. So I've taken you on sort of a walk through plasmonic nanoparticles as artificial molecules, and I've taught you about how you can make steam without boiling water by using this very elegant aspect of physics related to light localization. I've introduced a little bit about how we can use the same effect is very important in cancer therapeutics, which is now in the clinic, and how we can also use some of these ideas for looking at solar remediation processes. Not photovoltaics, but solar, something that's also very, very important, and that is water purification. So I have a wonderful group of collaborators, my students, and this list is always sort of getting out of obsolete, but many of my collaborators at Rice, better yet to just show you some of the smiling faces in my research group. So these are the very courageous people who do a lot of the wonderful experiments in the laboratory and also outdoors. And probably last but not least, so the star of the show is actually Aurora Neumann, and this is the rig that I showed you earlier. We took this up for 3 cloudless days in Seattle, Washington, to show this guy what his, so this is Aura, and this is Bill, he could actually see. And just as Aura was stunned by the person talking to her about the beer, she, after Bill walked away, she said, "That man was so, he asked such interesting questions, who was he?" So with that, I hope you don't feel as clueless as she did at that time, although she's a remarkably brilliant scientist. So I want to thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Is this on? Thank you for your talk. It was amazing. I'm not a physicist. I just want to disclaim this in advance. I'm a biologist. So I'm a cancer biologist. And I'm a firm advocate on frying cancer cells. So, your system is fantastic. But at the same time, I feel a little bit discouraged because in the second part of your talk, you mentioned the influence of the concentration of the nanoparticles. And that is going to be a serious problem for a tumor because there is absolutely no way that we can control that. And I can picture people using light for superficial tumors, treating with these nanoparticles, they will cause necrosis, meaning that part of the tumor will die, but eventually it might relapse. I was wondering if in your research, I'm aware that you probably were not the person that did those experiments, but whether there was a follow-up on those animals treated with your particles, and if you noticed that there was any relapse. And the other problem that I oversee in this part, and I hope you solve the problem in the future, has to do with a light penetrance, right? I mean, it doesn't go really far, so we're talking about tumors that they're eventually superficial. Not that we don't want to cure those, but...
Yeah, so obviously what I showed were subcutaneous tumors, and there's many different variations of this. So those problems have been... So those original data was from about a decade ago, and there have been many, many ways in which those problems have been addressed. So first of all, you can... So changing the nanoparticle size. So, for example, we have gone from nanoshells to nanomatrushkas, actually, which are more absorbing and less scattering. That can certainly play a role. I kind of mentioned when I talked about this that the company that's developed this uses this actually delivers light as a fiber optic probe. They don't deliver this through, and so that's actually great for prostate cancer because they, with this improved imaging. So the big revolution in prostate cancer was that they could image using a combination of ultrasound and MRI and detect twice as many problems with tumors as were detected before. But because they have these great images, they can then go in with very, very localized probes and have such minimal damage but still be ablating the tumors. And so their approach, being able to deliver light from different angles, this has been very useful. This is also being done at a network of about 8 veterinary hospitals where with canine tumors, they tend to be rather large. The tumors are often on the extremities. And so that's where going in multiple times into a tumor so you have complete light access is actually very, very useful. So in all of these cases, then looking at follow-up is actually very, very important, and looking at whether one can, how complete the treatment is has dictated the protocol for how this is done. So it's really sort of an engineering, light delivery problem.
I see.
But that's been really addressed. But thank you for thinking about this, because it's a very big issue.
So I'm thinking of the aerosol part of the steam. Do you find that any of the nanoparticles find their way into the steam?
Very good question. And we have never seen any particles conveyed in the steam. So that's like a cavitation type effect. And we haven't seen that. And so, for example, in this original sort of parabolic dish that we built, that solution, the solution where the nanoparticles are sits at the focus of the dish. And so we actually have had that sitting at Rice and being used month after month for several years. And we see very little deterioration of the nanoparticles, and we never see this conveyed in the steam condensate.
Cool. Thanks.
So since it doesn't really, you said it's just like a solution of the nanoparticles in the water, does that mean you could like make it into a spray and coat things with it? And then would it just like scorch the surface or something?
So you need a little bit of depth. So we're actually for the way we make the membranes, that's actually sort of how we do this. So obviously for the membranes, it's no longer a liquid. The membrane, we actually make this thin layer. And so the layer is made with a combination of polymers and solvents and particles that actually allow us to essentially something close to spraying it on. So we originally started with some people who did electrospinning, so the original result there, but we thought electrospinning is kind of labor intensive. Could we do something really simple and lower tech? And so you can actually do a very simple, to make that kind of light absorber there, which essentially is doing exactly what we described as a for vaporization, that you can make it in a simple, almost a spray type approach.
Okay. So like if it was, if you got the layer, I guess if you made it into a spray thick enough, then it could be put on anything, and you just have to have it in the sun and it would burn? Or does that make sense?
It depends on what you want to do, right? So if you want to, for vaporizing, you could certainly make this in a bunch of different forms. So I mentioned earlier this group from MIT who had been doing this. So they studied the same effect that we were working on, and they did it in a very different way. They used exfoliated graphite, so they have like a little hockey puck of basically a sort of, what essentially a scatterer and absorber, but they built it with a material and they didn't build it with particles. But it has a very similar type of effect, and they also can do very concentrated steam. They can put this on the surface of water, and then they can do steam production, using that as the absorber.
Oh, cool. Thank you. You said that there was a sort of Goldilocks zone in terms of concentration, how effective these things are. For steam generation of longer time periods, I would assume that the concentration would go up and so the Goldilocks zone would move further away. Do you have a way of compensating for that, or?
Very good question. So very often, so for example, if we have a, so the parabola where we have the fluid is in this focus of the parabolic dish. So what we actually had was we had foot pumps. So we had a foot pump. So as soon as the water level went down, we would just, with a simple bicycle type pump, you just pump more water into the area. So you can always be replenishing the water. Mm-hmm. And in the case of membrane distillation, it has a flow, and you can use a very simple solar pump just to flow the water into the active region. So yes, of course, you have to worry about, if you lose the water, you can't make steam, right? So you have to you have to replenish and so on. So, but it's really actually quite easy to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for the question.
Thank you again for the talk and the discussion about your research. I'm going to parrot the question that the young lady came up here and asked earlier. When you're dealing with, say, the sterilization of instruments in the field all the way to waste treatment or even distillation, thinking about the longevity of a nanoparticle like this or systems of this nature, do you see any residual nanoparticle activity anywhere along the line? And if not at this point, do you foresee or predict any either buildup or residual detection of that over time?
Well, so the nanoparticles stay in solution. So for example, they, over time. So I've had undergraduates also work with this, and sometimes they really abuse this system, like they backflow dirty water into the dish or something. So we've abused this thing, but particles are quite massive, and so they will after over time, because concentrations and so on change, they will fall out of solution. But then as soon as you begin to illuminate them, you tilt them towards the sun, you get they redisperse. And so you have the same effect. So we haven't noticed anything. Don't notice any cavitations. The same amount of nanoparticles seems to stay there, and that seems very, very stable. And that's also obviously very good, because it's sort of a permanent part of the equipment. You put in the nanoparticles, and you don't have to replace them or be replenishing them. So we haven't seen any of that kind of deterioration. So So it seems just really remarkably boring.
Thank you. It seems like a very robust system. So.
What does it say on your hat, by the way?
Monster Cat.
Oh, thank you.
It's an electronic artist. I just remembered my other question, though, because you were saying how it's for the desalination part, where you can just heat up a lot, it doesn't take any fossil fuels. I'm just in an LCA class, so I'm used to this like life cycle thinking. How hard is it to make the particles? Like, is that an intensive
process? So for a lot of these applications, we started to use carbon black because it was very inexpensive. Carbon black is made in many different countries. Carbon black is, if you use ink, carbon black is in many, many different applications. So anyway, it's usually made by taking organic matter, like, for example, corn cobs, and putting them in an oven, so you can, it's a carbon that's made from organic matter. And so it's for those of you who are chemists, it's actually carbon black is all sp2 carbon, so it's like a graphenic nanoparticles, and so there's some other interesting science questions about the properties of carbon black. But it is relatively inexpensive to make. If you're going to make a fire, in fact, if you've ever eaten barbecue, you've probably eaten carbon black. So
Okay, sweet. Thank you.
Yeah, well, it's what makes it crunchy and good. And I can say that as a Texan.
Hi, in one of your slides talking about the sterilization, you said that you could even destroy virus capsids. So I was wondering how you tested for that, or if you looked at other effects on the microbial community from steam generation in this way versus standard methods.
So we wrote a paper on this about 3 years ago. It's in PNAS, and we describe all of the ways in which we tested the different systems that we did test and how we were tested. So they were all sent to analytical laboratories. So what we did was we tested primarily for bacteria in that. But if we look at the temperature range that we can get to easily, then we certainly could. I mean, it's much harder to test for the for viruses, but we get into the range where one could expect to see viral inactivity. So.
Very brief. I just want to thank Professor Halas again. That was a wonderful lecture on nanoparticles, and there are many applications, certainly way more applications than I knew about, and you nanoscience students can see all the interesting things you can do with your knowledge. So that was fantastic. Thanks again. I want to thank again Mark Sowers for your great support of this series. You see how well it's working out so far, and we're looking forward to more. And thanks to Dean Morton and her staff for supporting this series. Jenny Orzalek and Katie LaFon back there, thanks a lot. And I just want to advertise the next talk in this series. As Dean Morton said, there will be five. Two will be in the fall, but one more this academic year. It's on Thursday, April 27th at 7:30 p.m. It's Professor Art McDonald from Queen's University. He's a 2015 Nobel laureate in physics. And his talk title is going to be How Unusual Going 2 kilometers Underground to Study the Sun and the Space Between the Stars. So what he's going to tell you about is what he and his collaborators did to solve a 50-year-old problem called the solar neutrino problem. That's what he won the Nobel Prize for. But he's not resting on his laurels. They're using the same facility and a new detector to look at the space between the stars, which is something we know is dark matter, okay? And we're still trying to learn about that. So I look forward to seeing you then, and have a great evening. Thanks for coming out. And thanks, Professor Halas, again.